Good morning.
Morning.
It's good to have you with us this morning. We have asked Mr. Pete to join us this morning, so we're glad to have him with us. We're going to have prayer in a little bit for Mr. Pete and his wife. They're going to do some traveling, so we're going to be praying for them later in the service, but we ask him to join us this morning. So let's all be standing together, if you would, please. And let's bow our heads together for prayer. Father, we thank you so much because you're a good God. You're a good, good Father. We thank you for loving us so much, Lord, that you gave your only Son to take the punishment for our sins and to die on the cross in our place, so that we could follow him into your presence to live with you for eternity. None of us here this morning deserve that, Lord, but we know that it's because you loved us. And Lord, we love you today, and we ask you to help us as we come before you to sing and to think and to pray about what a good God you are. So we pray that you would help us, Father, because we need to look into your face. When we look into your face, Lord Jesus, everything on this earth that would trouble us or burden us or give us problems seems to fade away because of your greatness and your power and your majesty and your love. Pray you help us, Lord, to stand and look in your face for these next few minutes. Bless our pastor as he's preaching in U-Haul today and then coming here to preach later. Father, touch him. Help all that we do to honor you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. All right. The first song we're going to do is one that we're familiar with. How can I keep from singing? How can I keep from singing? Amen.
Amen.
That was weak. Amen. How can we keep from singing?
There is an endless song that echoes in my soul. I hear the music ring, and though storms may come, I am holding on, and to the rock I cling.
Here we go.
How can I keep from singing your praise? How can I ever say enough? How amazing is your love? How can I keep from shouting your name? I know I am loved by the King. My step and I fall down again. I can sing 'cause you pick me up. Sing 'cause you're there. I can sing 'cause you're can see.
Amen. Woo. Praise the Lord. Amen.
I might mention as well that it's good to have Miss Katie back with us today.
Amen.
You excuse her for having to sit. She's suffering from some back issues, but she's determined to do what God's gifted her to do.
Amen.
So here she is. You continue to pray for her. Oh, that song takes my breath, literally. This next song is an old one, and it's an old hymn I'm sure you're familiar with. I remember my mom singing this song when I was around the house playing, and she was a stay-at-home mom, and I guess that was common back then, more so than now, but she used to sing while she was walking around the house doing her chores. She'd sing this song, and every time I hear it, I can hear her voice. So this song's Blessed Assurance, Blessed Assurance. Jesus is mine.
Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood.
There you go. Praise the Lord.
Savior,
may be seated for a few minutes. Praise team's going to stay right here. And I'll try to catch my breath. I'm going to read some scripture this morning. And I'll ask you to excuse me because I'm reading from the King James Version. I don't know if you all can detect it or not. And the sound people kind of laugh at me when I tell them to put scripture up on the screen. They say, all we have is the New King James Version. That's okay. I'm used to the King James Version. And when I read, I stumble when I'm trying to read the New King James, especially when some familiar verses of scripture like I'm going to read here. But these verses of scripture, I can't even begin to tell you how powerful, and I know it's the Word of God, it's all powerful, but these seem to speak to us this morning. And we're going to sing a new song here in just a few minutes, and these verses of Scripture came to mind when I thought of this song. From Romans, the 8th chapter, I'm going to begin reading at verse 28. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose. For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he did predestinate, them he also called, and whom he called, them he also justified, and whom he justified, them he also glorified. What shall we say then to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? He that spared not his own Son, but delivered him up for us, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It's God that justified. Who is he that condemneth? It's Christ that died, yea, rather that is risen again, and who is even at the right hand of God, who also makes intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for thy sake, we are killed all the day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. 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 All right, let's all be standing. This next song is a little bit of a new one, and it's entitled, You Never Let Go. Aren't you glad God never lets go of us? Amen. Amen. You never let go.
Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, your perfect love is casting out fear. And even when I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back, I know you are near, and I will fear no God is with me, and if my God is with me, whom then shall I fear? Whom then shall I fear? Oh no, you never let go through the calm and through the storm. Oh, is coming from the heart that holds on. The glorious light beyond all compare. And there will be an end to these troubles, but until that day comes, we'll live to know you here on the earth. I will hear no evil, for my God is with me. And if my God is with me, whom then shall I fear? Whom then shall I fear? Until that day comes, still I will praise you, still I will praise you. Yes, I can see the light that is coming for the heart that holds on. There will be an end to these troubles, but until that day comes, still I will praise you. Still I will praise you. Oh no, you never let go through the calm and through the storm. Oh no, you never let go every high and every low. Oh no, you never let go, Lord, you never let go of me.
Aren't you glad he never lets go?
Amen.
All right, before we do this last song, as I mentioned a few minutes ago, Mr. Pete and his wife are going to be doing some traveling, and so they're going to be with us for a while. So we want to have prayer for them right now, and then we're going to do a very special song, and we're going to dedicate it to them. Before we do that, let's pray. Father, how much we thank you, Lord, for these lives that have touched the lives of so many in this church. And Father, now they're traveling, but they're not traveling away from your presence, Lord, because you're going with them. And we know, Lord, that you have made the way already for them. We just pray for them, Father, that you would continue to bless their lives, bless them as they travel, keep them safe. Bless them where they go, that your presence would go before them, that you would surround them with your love and your power, that you would bless them, Father, and help them to honor you. We pray these things in Christ's name. Amen. 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 This next song we're going to do a cappella. Now listen, your choir. And as such, you have to follow your director. I told the praise team a while ago, when I swing my arms, you all sing in timing with me, and that way, right, wrong, or indifferent, we'll all at least be together, okay? Because when you do a cappella, you have a tendency to listen to somebody here and somebody there, and we start slower and slower and slower, and we want to get out of here by noon today. So we're going to sing, and I'll try to get it in the key that'll be acceptable for us. But this song is entitled, Great is Thy Faithfulness. Great is Thy Faithfulness. Here we go.
Great is Thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with Thee. Thou changest not Thy compassions, they fail not. As Thou hast been, Thou forever will be. Great is Thy faithfulness, great is Thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see.
Father, we thank You for the blessings that You've bestowed on us. And this morning we come to be fed by the fellowship and friends that we have here, but also fed, most importantly, by Your Word. So we pray that You give Word to the pastor, that Your Holy Spirit would move through him and in turn fill us with Your Spirit. It's in Your holy and precious name. And all God's people said, Amen. You may be seated.
Amen. If you have your Bibles with you, go ahead and pull them out. We are in Colossians this morning. We are kicking off a new series as we're going to walk through this great epistle. Colossians chapter 1, we're going to be looking this morning at the first 14 verses. Colossians is a prison epistle, as many of you know. That means Paul wrote it while he was incarcerated in Rome, and he's writing really to combat a lot of false teachings that are creeping within the church, and he's wanting the church to stand strong and to stand true and to stand on the gospel. The best way to combat that is to bring Jesus front and center. And his Christology in this epistle is second to none other. And we're going to see that in the upcoming weeks as we just seek to exalt the name of Jesus. And Paul does that in this epistle. And so he's writing to them and saying, keep your eyes focused on Jesus. Keep your eyes focused on Jesus. And so this morning is somewhat of an introduction, but in that there is just so much that is in it, these first 14 verses for us. We could spend a few weeks here. We're only going to spend one Lord's Day looking at it. But the big idea, the big theme of what we're talking about this morning is being called out. I hope my prayer is that as we grow together as the body of Christ, that we understand and we grow in understanding the value of the one another and the fact that we're called out. And there are no professionals at the foot of the cross's level. We're all followers of Christ, and that we've been called out to follow him. And we, like the Colossians, are dealing and living in difficult days. And there's all types of just noise and false teachings and just so much stuff that's around us. It is very easy to just become bewildered and even lose our way along the way. And we've got to, as a church body, just focus on Jesus and seek to exalt him and to know him more. And so that's my prayer, that's my hope for this series that we walk through over the next few weeks. Before we turn to verse 1, I want to share a verse with you in 1 Timothy, you know this, 2:9. I think this speaks to, 1 Peter, throw it up there, I misspoke. In 1 Peter 2:9, he really speaks to, Peter does, the heart of really the big idea for today in what I'm trying to communicate. He says, but you are what? A chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that you may what? Proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. If I was to ask you this morning, what does it mean to be a follower of Christ? What is the church? In a lot of ways, we're called ones. We've been called out of darkness into light. We're called into the family of God. We're part of the body of Christ. And there's the local body, and then there's the universal body. But if you know Christ, you've been brought from darkness to light. And then we have a calling on our lives. A lot of times when you think of calling, you think of a pastor that may be serving in a vocational ministry. And say, well, a pastor's been called to preach. Well, here's the reality. We're all called. We all have a calling on our lives. And we're going to see this morning the value, not only of understanding that we're called, but the value of one another and understanding how important it is for us to collectively pray for one another and stand in the gap for one another and understand the power of being a part of the body of Christ. In Colossians 1:13, and we're going to back up to verse 1. In verse 13, Paul says that he, meaning Jesus, in verse 13, has delivered us from what? The power of darkness. He's conveyed us, he's transferred us into what? The kingdom of his Son. So in that, if Jesus is your Savior, you've been called out of darkness into light, you are a child of God, and if you're a child of God, you're part of the family of God, and in that, we're here for a purpose. Not just, I mean, there's a rhyme, there's a reason. There's a purpose that he's put us here, and he's doing a work in our lives, and no matter how dark it may be, no matter how crazy society may get, no matter how much even false teachings may be around us, we are called in this season, this time, out of darkness into light, to penetrate that darkness with light, with the gospel, and to demonstrate what it means to know God and walk with God. And so Paul is going to, I think, remind the church at Colossae that you are called ones, just as he is. And so with saying all of that, let's go to verse 1. We'll walk through these next 14 verses. Big idea, keep in the back of your mind that you are a called person if Christ is your Savior. Called out of darkness into light. Paul says that he is an apostle, a sent one of Jesus Christ by the will of God, and Timothy his brother. Standard introduction. He said, to the saints, the body of believers, the body of called people, children of God, saints, and faithful brethren in Christ who are in Colossae. So here's something. They're not only in Christ, but they're in Colossae. You're not only in Hardyville at Red Dam, but you're in Christ if you are what? A follower of Jesus Christ. If you've trusted him as your Savior, if you've been called out of darkness into light. And that means that Christ is in you and you're in Christ. In other ways, put it, Christ sits at the right hand of the Father. The scripture says that we're in Jesus, but in the same sense, the scripture says that Jesus is what? In us. So we had to understand and have a real clear understanding of our identity is so wrapped up in Jesus because he's the one that has delivered us, right? He's the one that has delivered us from darkness and given us life. We're in him and he's in us. And we are bound together as a body, one another, because of Christ. That's why we are together. We are part of the family of God. He says, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. His standard introduction. And you're not going to have peace if you don't first experience what? Grace. And if you've experienced the grace and you know what it means to be forgiven, Cheryl Christine sung in Ridgeland this morning. That's why she wasn't here. And she got up and she sang the goodness of God. And it was really good and it was powerful. And the Spirit of the Lord just blessed that service. But she said, you know, God, I want to sing of his goodness, she said, because God in his grace has just been so powerful and such a blessing to my life. And because of that, she's experienced what? Peace. The grace of God brings the peace of God in our lives. Why? Because we're called ones. We've been called out of the world into the family of God. Verse 3. And so Paul says, we give thanks to God and to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, praying for you always. So now we're going to kind of get into the meat of the message. The plane is left. We've shot off. We're going to get into the text of the main part of the text we want to look at this morning. And Paul, remember, he's incarcerated. He's writing back to this church. There's some debate if whether Paul had even been to this church yet at the time of writing, for the simple fact is that in verse 2, he says, some of you haven't even seen my face before. If he hadn't been, it's more than likely through Epaphras planted this church, but Epaphras would have been a convert of Paul. He has a connection to this church, just not exactly sure how this church was birthed. But Paul is saying, we're here. Epaphras is in Rome with Paul. He says, we're here and we're giving thanks to God. And what we're going to see as called ones, once again, we're going to see the value of one another. I can't stress that enough. The value of the church and the body of Christ in one another. So he says, we give thanks to God and the Father of the Lord Jesus Christ, and we're always praying for you. I love that he says that we're not sometimes praying for you, we're not praying for you every now and then. He says, we are praying for you always. Now, here's the thing. When you go back to verse 3, he says that we're praying, but how is he praying? He's giving thanks for them. So let me ask you this question. In your own personal prayer life, one, what does it look like? And we ask that question a lot. What does your own personal prayer look like? Because if you're not praying, then you're not in fellowship. Because the scripture and the word and prayer, communion, it has to be there. If you're too busy to pray, then you're just too busy and you need to slow down and get some things out of your life. Right? But he says they're praying, but in their prayer, it's part of their prayers, they're giving thanks for God for what he's doing in the life of the believers at Colossae. In your prayer life, one, if you're praying, and hopefully you are, two, do you ever give thanks? Because if you're like me, you get caught up in, God, I need this, God, I need that. God, in this person's life, God, would you move over here? God, would you open this door? Would you open that door? And it's just, you know, request, request, request. Nothing wrong with requests, Paul says, even to the church at Philippi, another Philippians, another prison epistle, make your requests known to God, right? He wants to know our requests. But he says, with thanksgiving. So, in your prayer, does your prayer time ever involve thanking God for his goodness and for his grace and for his mercy and for what he's doing in your life? I think most of us, if we drill down to that next level, we struggle in that area. And you know what happens is, if we're not careful, all we will begin to do is focus on what we don't have or what prayer isn't being answered, and we're not thanking God and rejoicing before him for what he has done and what he is doing. All right, so that's the convicting part, right? I'm there with you. I know I'm on a platform, it's because I'm proclaiming the word, but we're all at the equal footing at the cross, and right, we're worshipers. We're not just spectators. We are participants. God, speak to us. God, show us what we need to hear this morning as we submit ourselves collectively to the word of God that we're walking through. Because the word is living, and we serve a living God. So, is there any thanksgiving, any thankfulness in your prayer? That's convicting enough. But here's where it gets even more convicting. Paul's not thanking God necessarily with what God's doing in Paul's life. Paul's thanking God for what God's doing in the church in Colossae's life. When is the last time you thank God, but doubling down, better yet, when is the last time you thank God for what he was doing in someone else's life? That is the power of the interpersonal relationship and the power of the body of Christ. Paul says, God, he says, I am making intercession and I am praising God for the work that he's doing in your life. You say, well, what work is he doing? Well, look at verse 4. I'm glad that you asked. He says, since we heard of what? Your faith in Jesus Christ and your love for all the saints. And then we're going to see in verse 5, because of the hope. Faith, hope, right? Faith, love, hope. Faith, hope, love, however you want to word it. But those are the three foundational things. And Paul says, we are thanking God. Why? Because you're walking by faith. We are thanking God because you are modeling what it means to bear with one another and genuinely love one another. We are thanking God because you are resting in the hope. By the way, the hope is not a hope-so, it's a no-so hope. It's a confident expectation, right, of the resurrection, not only of Jesus Christ, but of the believers who die in the Lord, absent from the body, present with God, that the grave has been conquered. So listen to what Paul's saying here. He's saying, guys, I want you to know that we are like just thanking God and rejoicing. By the way, they're walking through tough times. They're going through fiery trials. One of the heroes of the faith is incarcerated. There's a lot of unknown. Church has walked through a lot of upheaval, fiery trials, lives turned upside down. It's very costly, but they're walking by faith. You know, I can't tell you that tomorrow is going to be any brighter than today. Chances are it's going to be darker. But I can tell you this, if you're called ones, you've been called out of the darkness into light, and God wants us to walk by faith. And resting on the truth of the gospel, resting on the man Christ Jesus. Into living by faith and walking by faith. And not only to walk by faith and to live by faith and to stand on the gospel, even when nothing else makes sense, it's the gospel. Trust in the Lord, what? With all of our heart, lean not on our own understanding. In all our ways, acknowledge him and what? He'll direct our path. That's the promise of Scripture. Walking by faith, trusting in him. Faith is so huge because God says, walk with me, trust me. I've given you my word, I've given you my spirit, walk. And one of the things about faith, he's not going to give you step 3, 4, and 5. He's going to give you one step at a time. He says, trust me, walk by faith. And Paul says, we're rejoicing because you're doing that. He says, but not only are you walking by faith, he says, your life is marked by love for one another. Now we may be of the mindset, man, I'm walking by faith, but we're just as disgruntled and miserable and just biting just gnawing at one another with our words. Then I want you to know that we aren't focused on Jesus and we're not really doing a good job walking by faith when we become like that. Because when we walk by faith and our eyes are on Christ, naturally what's going to happen is we're going to develop this supernatural love for one another and we're going to see the value of the body of Christ. Remember what Jesus said? He says that they will know you by what? Your love for one another. Your love for one another. You know, one of the biggest injustices we've done, the church, I put myself there, over the last 30 or 40 years, is that we come in on Sunday morning, we talk about the love of Christ, we talk about how great and how awesome our God is, we raise our hands, we have all types of praise and worship, and then we walk out of the church door, we've walked out of the church doors, and we've just destroyed one another. Our kids come to business meetings, especially in the Baptist world, and they see something that someone sees something they don't like, and they just see us just devour and just really just show ourselves in a very poor way. And you know what's happened to the younger generation? They've looked at the church, those that's grown up in it, and says, well, if that's what it means to be a follower of Christ, there's a huge disconnect, and I don't want anything to do with it. If we're going to walk by faith, one of the ways that God's going to challenge us to walk by faith is bearing with one another and genuinely loving one another, even when we're not all that lovable. Paul's rejoicing because this church right now, even in fiery trials, is what? Is walking by faith, and they're genuinely loving. And why can they do that? Because they are absolutely convinced of the resurrection. Because of the hope of the resurrection. If the Lord tarries, I think three things are going to happen to the church. The church is going to have to learn to walk by faith again. I'm talking about the church in North America. The church is going to rediscover the value of one another. And we're going to have to learn in the face of persecution to stare death down and say, you have no hold over me because the grave has been conquered. And believe truly in the power of the resurrection. The day and age of the social benefit of being identified with the body of Christ is over, and it doesn't need to come back. Because when the social benefit, what happens is you have the politicians and you have, you know, the business, you know, everybody that thinks there's a benefit with being a part of Christ, what can I get out of it? You know, everybody wants a part of that, and it's all about self, right? But man, when it's costly, and it's, you're not going to benefit from it from a financial standpoint, you're not going to benefit it from it from a social standpoint, but it's going to cost you. Now, don't misunderstand me. There's politicians that come to know Christ that can serve in that capacity. There's certainly business owners and some of you in here that can use your business for the glory of God. There's not a negative in any of that. It's just that when your heart is not right and it's all about what can I get out of it, then there's no true transformation that's taking place, and it's self-serving. The refining fire of the church in the season that we're just beginning to enter into is where it is going to be extremely costly to be a follower of Jesus. And I don't think that's necessarily a bad thing, because it's going to be refining fire. It's going to give us an opportunity to walk by faith. And in that, we're going to understand and see the value of one another. And we're going to have the hope of the gospel. I mean, even as a church body over the last 2 years, and not only as a church body, collectively as a society, we've seen so much just death. And the only way you can face that, the only way you can put one foot before the other, is to be absolutely convinced that you know that you know that you know. This church was that way, and Paul says, I'm rejoicing because of that. Verse 6. He says, which has come to you, and it has also gone to all the world and bringing forth fruit, talking about the gospel, and is also among you since the day that you heard it and knew the grace of God in truth. As also if you've learned from Epaphras, it says, our dear fellow servant, who is a faithful minister of Christ on your behalf. So Epaphras is a servant in Rome. So what is Paul saying in all of this? He says, listen, he says, we're not only rejoicing because the gospel is going forth in you, in your faith and in your love and in your hope. He says, but Epaphras, who's modeled, who may have been even the one who's planted the church, he says that you've seen it in him. It's going forth everywhere. And so here's just a simple application for us as we think about, once again, being called out. It's very easy when you see so much darkness and you see so much craziness around you to say, you know what? Am I the only one that loves Jesus? Am I the only one walking by faith? You know, is there any real believers around that are genuinely walking by faith? And the answer is absolutely. And God is at work all across this globe through the gospel and the power of His Spirit through people. He's at work in China. He's at work in Muslim countries. He's at work in South America. He's at work here in North America because the gospel has the power to transform people's lives. And while we may not see it all, and may not understand all, I promise you, the gospel's going forth, people's lives are being transformed, and God are bringing people out of darkness into light and calling them into the family of God. And that should bring us encouragement because we should run the race with endurance. So when you get to verse 8, he says, who is declared to us by the love in the Spirit. Verse 9, he says, for this reason, since the day we've heard it, we have not ceased to pray for you. And so Paul says, we're not only giving thanks, he said, but this is how we're praying. So when you think about your prayer life and you think about being called and you're part of the body of Christ, my question to you is, does your prayer life extend past you and your circumstances and maybe your family? Because the average person, as long as me and mine are taken care of, that's all that matters. And that's selfish, and it's narcissism because it's the love of self. Nothing wrong with praying for self, nothing wrong with praying for family, but you are part of the body of Christ, and we need to pray for one another. We need to rejoice with one another. We need to celebrate with one another, right? Because we're part of this family. And so what does that look like? He says, for this reason, since the day that we heard of it, we do not cease to what? Pray for you. So what does Paul's prayer look like? And this is powerful, because if you want to know how to pray, Paul's going to show you how to pray. He says, this is what we pray that for you. He says, that you may be filled with knowledge of His will. When's the last time you prayed for another brother or sister that's walking through something and saying, God, would you give them knowledge of what your will is in that circumstance or situation? Would you reveal? Would you reveal to them and give them the knowledge of what they need to know as far as what your will is in that situation? Could you imagine being a part, and this is what should be happening here, a part of a church to where you've got brothers and sisters that are praying for you, and as you're walking through something and you don't know what to do, brothers and sisters that are standing in the gap praying for you to know the will of God in any particular situation that you're walking through. Or better yet, to not only know, but what? In all wisdom and spiritual understanding. All wisdom and spiritual understanding. You know, it's one thing to have the knowledge, it's a whole other ballgame to have the skill set to know how to live that out. So he says, I'm not only praying that you know, I'm praying that you have the wisdom to be able to live it out, and I'm also praying that you have the spiritual understanding of really what's going on behind the scene. I was in a prayer group this week with a group of guys, and we were sharing some prayer requests, and one of the guys piped up and of the situation that we were talking about, and really just spoke volumes and saying, you know what's really going on there is that person's dealing with shame. And I never even thought of it, but what I understood, it was a safe environment, it was brothers that love each other, it was brothers that pray together, and when he said that, it was like, wow, he saw something that I didn't see, and what was it? It was spiritual understanding. And so what happened? We knew how to pray specifically for that situation and to stand in the gap and say, God, give knowledge of your will. God, give wisdom. God, help move in this situation. Paul says, we're praying for you like that. Verse 10, he says that you may walk worthy of the Lord. How many of you want to walk worthy of the Lord? You want to live worthy? Where the walk is just an idiom. It's to flesh out. It's to live out your faith for Jesus, fully pleasing Him. So how do you do that? It's real simple. He says to be fruitful in every good work, meaning that the Spirit of God will produce His fruit in your life. You want a passage of Scripture to tie to Colossians 1:10? Put John 15. Jesus says that if you abide in me and I in you, He says what? You'll what? Bear much fruit. So Paul's praying that they would walk worthy. They would bear the fruit of God, and that's the power of one another. Praying, we're called ones. We're not to be like the world. We're to pray. We're to stand in the gap for one another, that God would do His work in our lives to produce His fruit. Why? That we may increase in the knowledge of what? Of Him. That we can know Him more. Your whole purpose is you want to meet God, and you want to know Him more. You want His life to be manifest in our lives and in your life. Verse 11, strengthened with all might according to the glorious power for all what patience and long suffering, that you may endure what? With joy. All right, so listen up for everybody. You're kind of nodding off. Listen up to this point. This is important. How many of you have went through a season in your life where the enemy could assist you? Now, we pray, Lord, protect me from the enemy, and we think of, okay, the enemy might get a hold of my wife and come at me, right? We don't think about the enemy getting a hold of us and using us in a destructive way. What fascinates me is that Paul is constantly praying for believers, and I think when you really drill down to what he's praying for, he's praying about them being sifted by the enemy, because we've been delivered from darkness to light, and the enemy, right, he does sift believers. He said that about Peter. Jesus did. He says, Peter, he says, in the upper room, he says, Satan's asked for you. He said, but what? But I prayed for you. So here's the deal. You ever found yourself to where you're just disgruntled and you don't like anybody or anything? And you find yourself talking about the body of Christ, complaining about this and about that and about everything else, and it's just nobody can do anything right but you. And that if you're really honest, you don't even do anything right, and you're not even really happy with yourself. Right? You ever been there? Am I the only one? No. We all have. That's why we got to bear with one another, right? Because, and some are moodier than others, I get it, but the enemy sifts, right? He sifts. What happens when the church not only celebrates what God's doing in someone's life, but is praying like this for people's eyes to be open to where they can see what God's doing and what the enemy's doing and combat it with prayer? That they may endure. Do not think that you can do this thing all by yourself. You can't. Do not think that you have all the answers. You don't. We need one another. We need the body of Christ that we can what? Endure. And the way you know that you're enduring and walking by faith is what? Your eyes are on Christ. You're loving the people. What else? You are bearing, Christ is bearing His fruit in you. And in that, you're enduring and you're being strengthened by the Lord. And you have patience, long-suffering, but yet your life is marked with joy. It's not going to happen apart from some good brothers and sisters standing in the gap praying and crying out for you. Paul's thanking God for what he's doing, but he says, I just want you to know I may be in prison, but we and my prayer team, we are holding you up in prayer because you're on the front lines. Be the people of God that he's called you to be. It's the power of prayer. It's the power of one another. It's the power of the body of Christ. And in our individualism that we've created in the North American church, we got to get back to understanding that yes, salvation is a personal thing, that you have to make that decision, but collectively we're in this together. I'm telling you right now, there's a group of ladies that meet on Wednesday. If you're a lady and you want to be a part of that, show up at 10 o'clock on Wednesday. You can jump in that prayer group. They'd love to have you. Is it 10 or 10:30? 10:30. I'm telling you right now, without a shadow of a doubt, if that group of ladies have not have prayed over the last 3 to 4 years that they've prayed, I would not be in ministry. Because I was done. I was tired of the grumbling, the griping, and complaining about everything under the sun. And I'm just like, Lord, I don't need to be a pastor, and I don't have to pastor a church to follow you. But here's the thing. If I'm going to follow him, I got to love people. And if I'm going to love people, then I got to do what he's called me to do. So what's kept my feet to the fire? What's helped me grow? What's been on? It's been a group of people praying for me. And we get before the throne room of God. Who has the greater reward? Those little ladies interceding and praying and crying out, or me standing up before you? The power of one another, the power of prayer, the power of true interpersonal relationships. Power bearing with one another, but yet staying true to the gospel message. What unifies us? It's not me. It's not my gifts. It's not a charisma. It's not any of that. You're here for one reason alone. It's Jesus Christ. Verse 12, giving thanks to the Father who is what qualified us to be partakers of this inheritance. Saints, what? In the light. Saints that are in the light. He's delivered us from the power of darkness. He's conveyed us. He's transferred us into the kingdom of His Son, in whom what we have, what? Redemption through His blood, forgiveness of our sins. And so in all of that, as just an introduction, Paul says, I am praying for you. I'm rejoicing in my prayers because God's at work. You're walking by faith. You're genuinely loving one another, and you're resting on the hope, and you've got that. Those are the foundational things. I am rejoicing because of the work God's doing. But just so you know, the gospel's going forth, not only there, not only with the work in Rome, but it's going forth everywhere because that is what called us. Jesus has called us out of darkness and light, and I am absolutely convinced that the gospel's going forth. He says, and I just want you to know, we're doubling down. We're not just rejoicing. We're making specific prayer for you. We're praying that you'll go and you'll grow, in understanding the will that God has for your life, that you'll not only have the knowledge of what His will is, but you'll know Him more. And as you know Him more, that you're going to have the skill set to live it out. And as you have the skill set to live it out before a lost and dying world, that the fruit of Christ is just going to show up. People are just going to see Jesus all over you in a Colossae. They're going to see it because you're walking by faith, you're loving one another, and you're resting on the hope of the resurrection. We're praying that you will endure, and that as you endure, that God's joy will just rest upon you, and it'll be a supernatural thing that only the Spirit of God can do. Why? Because you are forgiven, you've been called out of darkness into light, and Jesus Christ is alive today and forevermore. Now, you may be saying, you could have preached the whole sermon like in 5 minutes or 3 minutes with what you just went through. But in all of that, Paul is saying, guys, know who you are. Know who you are in Jesus. Know the power of one another. The power of prayer and the power that you're not in alone. So what say you this morning? What say you? Do you feel like a called out one? Christ is your Savior. He's called you out of darkness to light. So how do you respond? So I'm going to ask you to bow your heads. Your heads bowed, your eyes closed, and the praise team is going to come up. And here's what I want you to do. I know that the Spirit of God works in a powerful way. And as we read the Scriptures, we're submitting ourselves to the Scriptures, that the Spirit of God can take something that I said and just penetrate your hearts. So I said, you're not a spectator, you're a participant. So here's my question to you as you pray. Has the Spirit of the Lord spoken to you in any way this morning through anything that was said? Not only through the Word, but even through song. And if He has, how do you respond? This is you and God. Next question. When is the last time you rejoiced before God with the work He was doing in someone else's life? If we're honest with each other, when God's doing something in somebody else's life, we're not involved. We don't typically rejoice. We get critical. And then finally, is there anybody that the Spirit of God brings to your mind, to your attention, to say, pray for? Pray for. That they may understand the will. That they may know God more. That they may stand. That the fruit of Christ may be produced in their lives. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the truth of Scripture. We thank you for the family of God. Father, help us as a church to grow closer together, to genuinely love one another in a healthy way. Help us to become other-focused and not self-focused. Help us to be focused on Jesus, that in such a way that so much of the noise and negativity of just life just gets drowned out by the fact that we want to know him more. God, help us to understand that we have been called out of darkness to light. And help us to walk in it. We give you the praise, honor, and glory for it all. In Christ's name, amen.